today. So. From the new year, we have started a new journey about the mind. Perhaps you might have heard and did the practice where we discussed that, you know, it's like we all have big highways here and we have different lanes. Same way, that metaphor really fits into understanding the nature of the mind. So we have a mental highway and we have three lanes. So the lane number one or track number one invites unwanted, unwelcome thoughts. How do I know the lane number one? You are sitting alone and you have a bunch of thoughts, unnecessary, unwanted, about people, about the world, about life, about stress, about unwanted, unwelcome thoughts. So that is the lane number one. And the lane number two, where you are listening to me and putting the knowledge there. And the lane number three is the realization. What is realization? Knowledge is realized. A majority of the time, this knowledge is realized. Can I give you an example? Yes. Where are you sitting at my home? You don't need a thought. You don't need to think that you are sitting at your home and listening to it. Are you paying attention? Yes. You see, knowledge is realized. So when we are clear, what we are clear, when we are 100% clear means the knowledge is realized. What knowledge is realized? Peace and happiness in the lane three. Knowledge is realized. Peace and happiness in the lane number three. Then will you attend my sessions? No. Well, then I'm already in peace. I'm already in happiness. Now the next question comes, how many things you have realized? You are married or single, you realized. And a long list. Don't tell me how much bank account you have, how much money you have. You know it. You know it. Where is your house? You know it. But do you know what is the real self? Who am I? So when we answer who am I, you got a bunch of thoughts from the lane number one. I'm already having a lot of stress, you know, my life is blah, blah, blah. So that is what we discussed before, that lane number one, uninvited, unwelcome thoughts. And I ask you that same question. You have to think over it again and again whenever you are surrounded by anxiety, stress, duality and conflict. First thing you have to ask, who sent me the SMS or email or who called me that I should be stressed, angry, upset, reactive to a particular situation, to a particular person? No one sends me the message. And still I get upset. As if I have a birthright. How many of you have a birthright to get upset? We don't think about it. Because the very thinking helps us to understand whether I am worthy of suffering or not. We just get carried away. You have a sense of anxiety or reaction. You say this guy is bad and you know you reacted it and then we get upset. This is the function of the lane number one in our day-to-day life. We don't have a time to think. That is why I told you the Buddha warned. You know, everyone says this is mindfulness from the Buddha. But Buddha says, first understand, then we will practice meditation. So Buddha and many other masters, almost all the masters, says, don't blindly believe what I say. Buddha says about himself, don't believe me because others convince you of my words. Don't believe anything you see, read, or hear from others, whether of authority, religious teachers, or the text. What is the pointer? No blind belief. We have a blind belief about ourselves. You have a blind belief when you say that you are in stress, you are not worthy of suffering. No human being is worthy of suffering. But we claim, blindly, lane number one. I made it little easy to recognize lane number one. So what I should do, I should put the knowledge in the lane number two. How? By listening and learning from the teacher. Until what time? Millions of times. Only 1 million times. And once we put the knowledge, we are separating ourselves from the lane number one. You keep on driving on the lane number two in your life all the time. What is lane number two? No blind belief. I have to start thinking, my honey is crazy, you know. Everyone's honey is crazy. Let them remain crazy. For example, honey or your friend does not send you the message that whenever I meet you, the moment you start thinking about me, you react. You also become crazy. We don't get that message and still we become. That is why the Buddha says no, no blind belief. You have to think, you have to analyze, you have to ask a question when you are guided, when you experience the stress, suffering, anxiety, duality, conflict, any negative thought. Now let me find out first. So Buddha says, no, I have told you, I'm teaching you, I'm guiding you, but sit down and think about your life. That who am I? What is the goal of my life? Why he says this? Truth is important. Knowledge does not change. I gave you one example. We all recognize Charlie as a Charlie. Now, this is knowledge. Are you getting it? So simple. None of us amongst us recognize Charlie by a different name. Simple. So knowledge does not change. And why the knowledge of the truth does not change? The knowledge of the truth cannot be falsified. So our master says, our essential nature is permanent peace and happiness. That is the discovery of Eastern wisdom. We have to follow the path, we have to realize that knowledge. That is where, you know, you see in science, you have to be very clear understanding. I told you 120 years ago, I'm not criticizing science, but the approach of the science is different. 120 years ago, scientists told us that the world outside is the material world, it is made up of the matter, and the matter consists of atoms and molecules. So So is the science progressive in a relative field. Their truth, what the truth was 120 years, it changed. 20 years passed and they said this atom consists of electron, proton and neutron. Another 20 years, 30 years, it changed again. It says no, this electron, proton and neutron are particles, but they also behave like wave. So in science, we say it is a progress in science. Where is the progress in science? 120 years ago, the matter did not consist of electron, proton and neutron. It did not consist of waves. Are you getting it, what I'm saying? It still consists of the waves. So what was the problem? Why the scientists did not find 120 years ago? Can you make out? Error in perception. Scientists have corrected that error, that not only they consist of atoms and molecules, electron, proton and neutron, they behave like a wave, they are also an energy. And Einstein discovered matter converts into energy and energy converts into the matter around 50 years ago. So what is the point? Point here is scientific progress is based on removing the error in perception, error in the knowledge. So can I say that 120 years ago the scientists have a wrong perception that this matter consists of only atoms and molecules? The answer is yes. So what the Eastern wisdom does? Eastern wisdom says, first remove the wrong notions from the mind and you become a seeker, then only you can find the real self. We don't want to give any chance. We don't want to give any chance to the mind that if you continue moving on the lane number one, you will perceive wrongly. You will have a wrong perception. So it is better to take care of the mind first. Let the mind be clear. What is not clear? Mind is impure. Mind is impure. Why it is impure? Now you see how the Buddha and other master answers. Why the mind is pure? The current state of the mind is impure because I feel others are responsible for my suffering. That is impurity. But why I feel that others are suffering? What is impurity? Impurity means I have a desire of seeking peace and happiness from the world outside. What is the world? World of people, of place, of situation. And this is delusion. So I have to understand how the mind works in delusion, how the mind works in attachment, how the mind works in likes and dislikes. And then it gets agitated. Nobody sends me the message. See the logic and understanding and clarity. I am seeking peace and happiness from the others. The master says that peace and happiness is within me, here and now. Because I do not move to the lane number two, I made it clear. I continue to get carried away by the lane number one, which has unwanted, uninvited thoughts. That has an element of delusion, attachment and detachment that causes the stress and suffering. If I don't move to the lane number one, I am not worthy of suffering. My friends, we have to think. So when you are thinking lane number one, to you move to the lane number two, you are separating it. We already know, we all drive. So sometimes you drive in the lane number two, sometime on the different lane. So they are independent on the mental highways and they are interconnected also. If you get carried away by the lane number one, you'll have a problem. So what is this? in my head, I separate the lane number one from the lane number two. The moment you have a separation, that power of separation by the intellect through the thinking and reflecting is known as the power of discernment. Why I said power of discernment? Because the very first qualification to become a seeker is to use the power of discernment. Buddha says, no, don't believe me. Don't believe me, don't trust me because I said it. Because you have read about me, you have heard about me from the others, until you think about yourself. This is the power of discernment. We don't want to make a mistake, which the scientists make a mistake, correcting the error of perception. We want to be 100% clear that this mind has to be pure completely. It should act like a transparent mirror. The moment you stand in front of a mirror and the mirror is clean, it shows you your image. It doesn't show you anybody's image. The same way. So the first quality, I told you, the power of discernment. And then our mind remained focused on, who am I? So at present, whatever I know about myself, I have to examine whether that is true or not. I give you a simple example. The science says that I am a man. Do you see I am a man? So I am 51% man and 49% I have a characteristics at the physical, mental, emotional level of a woman. Only 1% difference is there. So we have four women here. They have 50%, 51% feminine. 49% is the man characteristics. I'm not saying science says this. In terms of your DNA structure and condition. That brings the changes in the shape and the form. And then we go on talking, I'm a self-made man. Sometimes women also say that I'm self-made women, you know. Self-made. Bring the material that made your body, then you can claim that you are a self-made man. Did you create your own body? So our logical thinking, the moment you think you separate lane number one and the two, the moment you separate, you have a clarity. Oh, these are the notions I have been carrying for so long, that the world is responsible for my stress and suffering. I become very clear about it. So the clarity in the mind removes the confusion and the delusion, and the mind becomes a qualified seeker. When we say that we have to become a qualified seeker, it means the mind has to be a qualified seeker. Look at the way this Eastern wisdom works. It doesn't say believe. No need to believe. You have to follow the path of the knowledge. That is why the master says, Manai manushyanam karanam bandhamokchayo bandhai vishaya sakta muktai nirvishayam mana. And before that, it says that mind, from where I got this idea of a metaphor of lane 1, 2 and 3, there is a verse. It says, manohi dividham proktam. Manohi dividham proktam, shuddham cha ashuddham eva cha ashuddham kama sankalpam, Shuddham Kama Vivarjitam. So that verse says mind is of two types, impure and pure. Then it defines in the another line, the mind becomes pure when it desires for peace and happiness from someone else in the world outside. Why? Because with that desire I project peace and happiness. What is projection? I superimpose. I will get married. That will bring happiness in me. Is any married couple happy? No, I'm just joking. So, is any single happy? Come on. Single is also expecting something more. Marriage is not a solution to be happy. And then we talk, my married life. There is no happiness whether to be single or to get married. Why? It is outer situation. Peace and happiness are located within me. Then you don't expect peace and happiness from your partner. But you first discover peace and happiness and you start expressing peace and happiness whether your partner agrees or doesn't agree. Doesn't agree, you are still happy. He or she agrees, you are still happy. Are you getting it? So that kind of independence, that kind of a freedom, our masters are teaching and guiding. That is the, you can say, that is the way the mindfulness works. You have to hammer your mind again and again. Then only we can realize, you know, why that awakening is too far, because I don't purify my mind. I said, okay, my mind is already pure, you know. I have little bit problem with others. No, there should not be any problem from any situation, any person, any relations in your life. Mind says, I'm calm. No situation can affect me. And the master gives those tools. So mind is impure because of the desire and the projection. Projection. So when there is a projection, what I project? I project happiness in my partner, in my dream, and then I see, you know, what a life being single, so let us get married. So that projection to secure happiness in the others, it starts the struggle from the day one. That is the thought coming from the lane number one. You're going to start fight with my partner. No, I'm not going to start, you know, a fight with your partner. I'm just telling you the fact. This is the fact. But it also doesn't mean that we should not marry. I'm not going there. Projection is the problem. One more thing and then we will do the practice. Does animal mind also project peace and happiness in others? Think of it. No, because their mind is controlled by the nature. Their mind has only the four basic instincts of security, of reproduction. Don't say sexual pleasure. Don't say sex. It's only meant for reproduction. Are you clear? Or you're not clear? So if you say they are for the pleasure,
the chimpanzee use sex to bond the group.
Yeah. They are associated because of this, because of the security, because of the security, their instinct helps us to remain in a group. So that comes with the security in a herd and the group. But other instinct is the reproduction, third is the food, and the fourth is the sleep. They cannot have a power of discernment because they are controlled by the nature. We have a power of discernment. So animal mind, again I'm comparing. Animal mind, lane number one. Why lane number one? And then we will go think of it, why lane number one? Animal mind. I can think, I will give you another thought before I conclude this topic, and then we will have our session, practical session. Animal mind cannot think of it. And you contemplate and reflect and find out if it is really true or not. Because only the human being amongst all the living species can receive the knowledge and retain the knowledge. And they can bring about a change by receiving and retaining the knowledge and applying that knowledge. I was just watching the Discovery Channel day before yesterday, and they said that in the Indian Ocean, in the spring season perhaps, millions of female turtle, they go on the sand and they lay about 150 eggs. And then they go into an ocean, they forget. They don't wait for the eggs to break up and become the babies. And out of 150, only 1% or 2% remain alive. Then what happens, you know, when the babies come, they break the egg shell and they make a noise, instinctual, it is instinctual. They make a noise so that the other babies are also ready to break the egg, and then they go together into an ocean. So that very learning is instinctive, habitual, mechanical. We can learn and listen consciously, we can receive the knowledge, we can use this knowledge that here are the two options, confusion or peace. I can choose that option. They are doing it mechanically, because we can do it consciously so that we can have a greater realization of what the life is. Let us close your eyes and we will start with the practice. Eyes are closed and position of the body, whatever the best position of the body, and check that, are you comfortable? Can you move in? You are settled in the comfort. How do I know? I know by my intellect. But how I can have experience of the comfort at the conscious level now, which I was not at all aware before? It was an animal mind. Now it is an intellect. I know consciously. You see that I can receive the knowledge and retain the knowledge. Unless we clearly understand these points, this mindfulness becomes a joke. 1 minute meditation, 2 minutes, 5 minutes. Be carefree and being comfortable. We will go together with these two steps. So look at the head and the neck. Are you clear? It's the lane number two. I believe it is clear. So when I say look at the neck joint, it is you are applying the knowledge, you are living with that knowledge, you are aware of the neck joint. But at the same time, the lane number one has a lot of thoughts. Let it be there. Don't you see the lane number one and two are independent? Let it come, let it go. Don't worry about it. When you have that power of awareness, of discernment, mindfulness will succeed every time. Now you know why it doesn't succeed. So looking at the neck joint being there, feel and experience sensation, comfort and steadiness. You are not finishing, destroying the lane number one. You are not participating in that lane. That is what I am saying. Lane number one, there is a noise coming from outside, the lane number one overpowers you. Move the mind on the shoulder joints, being there, feel the sensation, comfort and steadiness, the entire body. You look at the body, you are aware of the body, you feel the body. Can I guide these instructions to any living species? Answer is no. That is our specialty, that is our faculty. We are not using it. Why we are not using it? Lane number one overpowers me. Then I blame and complain. I had lot of the thoughts during the practice of meditation. That's why I'm not succeeding. And I am simply saying, let it be. Let there be. You continue with the knowledge. Instructions by the teacher is nothing but the knowledge. I am a catalyst. That discernment, only you can do it. So the being carefree simply means that lane number one will continue to have the thoughts at the subconscious level, at the conscious level, associated with the feeling and emotion of anxiety. Let it be. Only one thing, you are in a lane number two. Finished. And then you see that no one can break your comfort in being carefree. And then I added another part into it. So lane number two, we strengthen the lane number two. How? By the mantra. It has nothing to do with the cult and dogma and a belief. Sarve bhavantu sukhina. You say in your mind. Why? I want you to trigger your brain because you are learning something new. The words and the phrases in the song. Sarve bhavantu sukhina. Sarve bhavantu sukhina. And then think of it. The moment you start thinking, you move to the lane number two. What it means, let everyone be happy. No, but you have to think little more. Oh, why let everyone be happy? Because happiness is their nature. And we have a clear understanding. There is no living species in the planet or the universe who does not want peace. From the mosquito to elephant to the tiger, they are not even conscious because it is inbuilt. It is their essential nature. So it is my essential nature also. Lane number one prevents you to believe this. Lane number one, two, three, both, all three are present in your mind. It is your mind. Sarve santu niramaya. Sarve santu niramaya. Three times. Sarve santu niramaya. Let everyone be healthy. Who doesn't want the state of the well-being? Who does not? Consciously, unconsciously, animals, plants also. Why? Because that well-being is the nature of the real self. Sarve bhadrani pashyantu. Sarve bhadrani pashyantu. Sarve bhadrani pashyantu. Meaning, let everyone be blessed. Did I warn myself? No. Was I born? Before I knew how I will be born? Answer is no. So there is a blessing, there is a grace that we are born as a human being to receive and retain the knowledge, to apply the knowledge, to find our real self. And that is the greatest blessing in the grace. We don't realize it. Ma kaschid dukh bhag bhave. Ma kaschid dukh bhag bhave. Ma kaschid dukh bhag. Let none suffer from misery in this world. So when I think in this, I move to the lane number two from the lane number one. Otherwise what happens? I have a lot of suffering. What should I do? I react. I keep on thinking about the anger, hesitation, reaction. Nobody sends you the message and still I'm thinking. So that is why this mantra is evolved. Not one mantra. Many mantras have been discovered, validated. Oh, it is because of this reason. So now you see, you will find a sense of relaxation and a calmness because I am seeking that peace and that well-being and that happiness which is within me all the time. You are thinking, it means you are in a lane number two. Lane number one constantly push me. No, it is outside. I am affected by the outside situation, people, things. It is a self-discovery. It is not others' discovery. Others, outside. Self, inside. So because of this, Buddha says, it is better in the state of sensation, comfort and steadiness. Let your mind be engaged in the lane number two. That will produce the result on its own. You need not to worry about the result. So there are many ways of look at the breath. So when you look at the breath, what it means, you know the breath is going in and out. Do you know it? Check it. What do you mean by knowing it? You are aware of the breath going in and out. Thoughts are still coming in the lane number one when you are in the lane number two. But if your mind deliberately wants to make an accident, then who is responsible? I'm just making it clear. Let these thoughts continue to come. You are not participating in them. You are participating in the lane number two. You know the breath is going in and out. You do not change the rate and the rhythm of the breath. And you are feeling the sensation of the breath. I made it so simple. three-pointed awareness. Three-pointed awareness is knowledge. It is your experience. Now what should I do with the other thought? Do not participate. When you do not participate, you weaken the impact of the thoughts and feeling and the impressions of the lane number one. That is the only way. You cannot control, you cannot suppress. If you suppress, if you complain, you are giving a fuel to fire to the fuel, fuel to the fire. You know, my mind still gets carried away. So let us engage your mind in one deeper way. You are already looking at the breath going in and out, feeling the sensation of the breath. And do not change the rate and the rhythm of the breath. If you change the rate and rhythm of the breath, you know what happens? The lane number one does it. Even after listening. Why? Because we start participating. So the fourth point, the moment the breath goes in, count mentally in one, breath comes out, out one, in two, out two, in three, out three. Go on counting the breath. You are clear. You are consciously participating in counting the breath even when the lane number one constantly brings in the thoughts and feeling and the past and impressions and let it be there. Don't you see you keep on driving your car and other cars are also running on the highways? Your attention is always on driving your car. In a particular lane. Go on counting the breath. So when you recognize that you forget the counting, it is because of the lane number one. You may not recognize. But now we can recognize because I forgot the counting. When you forget the counting and your mind struggles that, oh, what was the number? Forget about the number. You restart the counting. It's not a competition. So that is how you do not participate in the lane number one. You participate. You are fully aware, moving with the knowledge in the lane number two. Now you stop the counting, and the next step is totally passive. You're just aware, you want to know. So you look at the head and the neck and experience the sensation, relaxation, and stillness. I'm not asking your mind to do anything. What is that? Lead number three. Again, I might make it clear, amply clear, that all the three lanes are present on the mental highway. You participate in the lane number two, you are full of suffering. Participate in the lane number two is what the teaching. Lane number three is the result. Look at the right arm. Sensation, relaxation, and stillness. Look at the left arm. Sensation, relaxation, and stillness. Chest in the belly. Sensation, relaxation, and stillness. Right leg, sensation, relaxation, and stillness. Left leg, sensation, relaxation, and stillness. So when you experience in the lane number three, that weakens the lane number one. That is the process of meditation or mindfulness. We weaken with a rich and deeper experience of the calmness and peace. You cannot struggle with the mind. Once you are 100% clear about this, the progress is faster. Do nothing, remain as you are. In the state of doing nothing, Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Shanti, Shanti. Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Bring your awareness on the right hand. Now you see, that is the knowledge. Your mind goes there. You don't move at this time. I simply said, move your mind on the left hand. Be aware, means you know. Now you do some physical action, lift your both the palms, place it on your eyes, open the eyes inside the palms. Don't leave anything blindly. Ask yourself, what happened? What were the problems and the challenges? Why? That is how we share our experiences. And bring the hands down. First, move both your palms on your eyes. Then open the eyes inside. Then know your experiences. Then bring the hands down. We will share our experiences now. Yes, Sophie, how are you?
I am good, Girish. I have a question.
Yes.
So, When you give the instruction, we listen to something that is outside, right? But it goes inside your mind. Yes.
That's how you understand. When we do the counting this time, it doesn't happen each time.
The sound was very loud. And I couldn't get my mind to stay with the counting. I always was going to this loud sound.
Yes, yes, it is again. Brain number one. So we keep on counting. We miss it, we keep on doing it. We persist patiently. And what happens? Gradually, the lane number one, you are not participating with it, and you move to the lane number two, and at present the result is calmness and relaxation. We need not to fight. It is the same mind. How can I fight my right hand with the left hand? Who will win? So that level of awareness should be there. I think I'm making, yes, you can ask those questions. So how are you, John?
Hey, Girish, I'm fine. Fairly carefree.
Wonderful. That's good. That's good. Carefree means carefree from the lane number one. And result is natural. We need not to ask. You are already definitely calm and relaxed. So I told you that we should always be aware that right hand cannot fight with the left hand. No one wins. No, I can make my right hand win. That is what is happening. You are making the lane number one win. Meditation, mindfulness is not the fighting and who wins and who wrestles. So how are you, Anne?
I feel fine, but I tried to fight sleep for some reason. I don't know why. I think I just was tired. There was the last few weeks. There was something going on which was stressful, and I think it was a kind of reaction to it.
Yes.
Couldn't stay awake.
No, it's okay.
I feel fine.
You sleep, you relax, but I said only okay part. So now let us understand a little deeper that when there are put up hormones, dopamine, if we give little more, even if you are too much tired, you won't get to sleep, but you will be relaxed. So many scientists so-called believe and suggested in their research studies when you are actually in the mindfulness state, means that you move from the lane number two to lane number three, many hormones are released and that fatigue is replaced into a relaxation. And then you don't need to fall into sleep. That comes later. It comes definitely. How are you, Mead?
Driving in lane number two.
Good.
I feel much more present and more with myself.
Much more with yourself. That is what we need to do in everyday life, in every situation, in every relationship. And when we do that in every relationship, you know, that is a very rough meaning of living in mindfulness. Or we can say living you might have heard, you know, we Americans use it even without understanding, or just living in a moment. So when people see me and I ask them that, oh, you had a lot of stress? Yes, I have a lot of stress. So are you living in a moment? Then they get more confused. So knowledge, Eastern wisdom is nothing but the knowledge that brings the clarity, that dissolves the confusion. And when the confusion is gone, the delusion is gone, the clarity is there. What kind of clarity? I gave you one clarity. Are you sitting at your home? You say, yes, there is 100% clarity. So do you know your real self? Yes, you have 100% clarity. You are living in a moment. You are in a state of meditation. Do you agree, John? John agrees, then everyone should agree. That's really good. Thank you. Thank you.